So to start us off in a good place, I want to make sure that we cover all of the material. Luis has asked us to hold off questions until the end, at which point in time we can open it up to the group and into the chat, depending on how you're accessing the meeting. So to begin, I want to acknowledge that the land we meet on is and across virtually is the traditional territory of the Mississauga of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, and the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples, and is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 signed by the Mississaugas of the Credit, and the Williams Treaty signed by multiple Mississaugas and Chippewa bands. And for people who are not aware, the Williams Treaty covers parts of Scarborough. I also want to acknowledge all treaty peoples, including those who came here as settlers, as migrants, either in generations, in this generation or generations past, and those of us who came here involuntarily, particularly forcibly displanted Africans brought here as a result of the transatlantic slave trade and slavery. And I think that it's really important for us to start off our day with this acknowledgement that that we center our learning in an active way, and we look to what we learn about here as a way to sort of incorporate it into the work that we do to address systemic inequities in public health and hopefully in our personal lives. So I would like to now, my pleasure, introduce Luis Mata from FCJ Refugee Center. Luis Alberto Mata is a Colombian refugee trained in human rights and in immigration and refugee issues. Luis is currently at FCJ Refugee Center as the Anti-Human Trafficking Program Coordinator, coordinating the Toronto Counter Human Trafficking Network, and the FCJ Migrant Worker Mobile Program. In Colombia, Luis worked with urban and rural communities, including forced displaced people. He reported on human rights abuses and also on the five-decade civil war in his country. Luis has lectured on globalization, social justice, and human rights, and has published two books, one about the links between the origins of the insurgency and poverty, isolation, and violence against rural communities in Colombia, and the second is on the genocide against the patriotic Union. Luis, in Canada, Luis has worked with grassroots organizations. Welcome, Luis, and I hand it over to you now.
Health for this invitation and everyone for being here in this beautiful morning. As Lisa said, I work for the FCJ Refugee Center as a human trafficking program coordinator, and I also coordinate the Migrant Workers Mobile Program. And I would like to say something brief about my organization. The FCJ Refugee Center has been working for over three decades supporting and working together shoulder to shoulder with immigrants and refugees and people in a precarious situation in the city. Particularly, it's an organization who have focused on those who have been dispossessed and non-status in a more vulnerable situation. We are a community-based grassroots organization. All the programs that FCJ deliver are delivered under the scope of anti-oppression and also under the gender equality perspective. And we have a concept that is an open doors for everyone, for everybody at any time. Those in difficulties, in challenges, trying to be integrated in this society and having no having knocking door other doors, but no solutions, then finally in the center they find just some hope, some horizon. This is the mostly general what we are as a center. We have several programs that make the identity and identifies the organization. One of them is the Refugee Claimant or Refugee Protection Division. That program works mostly with the students, students from law, from social work in the last year. And we provide a space for at least 7 students in every period, and they are filling forms, supporting clients, filling all the documents for the refugee process, but also humanitarian and compassionate applications, work permits, that kind of application we do here. And also we do the phone calls to the legal aid, and when the legal aid is not granted, then we take the cases. But otherwise we have a list of lawyers. Some of them are pro bono, but others just take the cases in with the approach that we have in the center. Also, we have a program for popular education. In this time has been an important moment for this program, because during the COVID-19 pandemic, we adapted to the new situation, and we have been providing info sessions and workshops, delivering all kinds of information and creating awareness about the situation of the migrants in the province and in the city through the webinars, and also organized presentations for specific organizations, like today that we prepared something special for this audience to open a discussion and to have like a open discussion table at the end about issues that are faced by migrants and refugees in a precarious situation in the city. Also, we have a program for housing. We have 3 houses for women who are victims of abuse and women with kids. And also we are part of the coalition, the housing coalition in the city. Then we look for partnership collaboration, also for referral, but also we have the space for at least 34 spaces for women that we can live in their houses. And also we provide support for them in a holistic approach in health, because we have a primary health clinic to attend people who is without status, without HIP, without insurance. We have a doctor, we have a psychiatrist, we have a nurse. They provide, as volunteers, provide the support in our clinic one or twice, sometimes twice per week, but mostly one day per week. And we have a youth network, a strong group, I will say, very active, doing advocacy, participating in events, also in educational programs and popular education. And we have now ESL classes, mostly for those who have nowhere to go because they don't have status, etc., and have been facing difficulties to be accepted in some school. They can come here. We have a couple of teachers who are volunteers provided delivering this ESL class. And finally, to speak about my program, the anti-human trafficking program, we address mostly international cases. We are prepared to address any case of human trafficking, because our leader, our manager and co-director of the organization, Lori Rico, has the expertise for more than 20 years involved in this field. She's away for these days for 1 month. But also we have a team. We have 2 case workers, one to attend remote areas in the province, but the other is a youth anti-human trafficking worker for the city, and also working in coalition, in partnership, in collaboration with other organizations in the city. And we have been developing some educational programs also to create awareness and to attend and to support those youth who have been victims and survivors of human trafficking. But another focus we have is the labor exploitation. We focus in human trafficking for labor exploitation, mostly because what is one of the strengths of the organization. That just I wanted to mention this in the center. We have a scope and a holistic approach to address the situation of the human trafficking. Today we are going to talk about human trafficking, particularly in international cases and labor and for labor exploitation. But I would like to mention a little bit what is the scope we use and we have for the approach we have for this program. Everything is based in the human rights approach, victim center, and as I said at the beginning, gender justice and anti-oppression framework. And I will explain why those perspectives to do the work is because mostly I'm going to go a little bit Okay, I'm gonna go later to that slide, but we look for the intersectionalities between the vulnerability and the precariousness in immigration, but also gender issues, and particularly for those who are here without status, they are a little bit more away from the center of the power. They are a little bit more vulnerable because they don't have access to the services. They also face other situations that is not direction, no horizon, or pathways to the permanent residency, which makes them a little bit more vulnerable and more easy to be victims of labor exploitation, particularly. Saying this, I will emphasize that there is, unfortunately, in the media, even in the government, not only in the Canadian, but internationally, and in general in the organizations, the focus has been made in sex exploitation, which is a terrible crime that we have several, many clients and victims and survivors of sex trafficking. However, we want to highlight that labor exploitation, slavery, is not mentioned or a little mentioned and is mostly ignored. And this is something that we wanted to highlight because the majority of the cases are related to labor exploitation. However, those are the less to getting attention from the media, even from the policies, etc. And the international cases is, as I said a few minutes ago, is because those who have no status in Canada have a little more challenges and difficulties and differences in order to address services and to get support in the city and in the province. We don't work alone. We work in partnership with many organizations. I would like to highlight some of them that we work a lot in cases like the Social Justice Legal Mobile Program. The Social Justice Legal Mobile Program is a group of lawyers working in several municipalities of the province, in Cinco area, in St. Catherine area, Waterloo, London, Hamilton, and all the south in Ontario. Those lawyers have been funded by the legal aid, and they are mobile. And because we have a migrant workers mobile program, yeah, we made the partnership, and then we have been addressing the cases. And the labor part, we get the support from this group of lawyers, and from the immigration, we provide the support or we refer them to our lawyers. That is an important partnership I wanted to highlight. Also, we have a coordination with other networks, the Migrant Rights Network, the CCR, the Canadian Council of Refugees, particularly for policy, for advocacy for policy change. And we have partnerships with Parkdale Community Legal Services, Legal of Windsor, and many other legal clinics that we make referrals and we work together, plus the organizations that integrate the Toronto Counter Human Trafficking Network. Just to mention that we coordinate, I'm the coordinator of the Toronto Counter Human Trafficking Network. There's more than 27, now it's 29 organizations, more than 100 people involved working against human trafficking. Most of them are focused in the sex trafficking. However, two or three organizations, particularly the FCJ, bring to the network the issue of the labor trafficking. And then we do collaboration, we do referrals, and we address the cases together for counseling, for housing, for contacting the police, the Ontario police, the OPP, but also the Crown Attorney when it's necessary, or other organizations that we need to address, CBSA immigration, to address cases and to find remedies and solutions for the cases. That is the way we develop the work. Something important is that we see the whole framework, and we invite everybody to see, please, the whole framework. Human trafficking happened here in Canada and many other countries, but The problem is not local. The problem is local, regional, and national and international. And international because now we have millions of people looking for refugees. And in some ways, powerful countries have been, if not provoking, at least looking to another side, ignoring situations that have been increasing dramatically the numbers of people looking for refugee around the world. And poverty, proxy wars, mining, extreme mining exploitation, all these things, and climate change have been provoking that people start exodus in different parts of the world, looking for a better life, looking for safety, and looking for a new space where to live their lives. And human trafficking has become one of the most profit business in that context, even higher than the drugs, the cocaine, and all these things. The human traffickers are getting more money because they have a lot of people and they have a lot of necessities around the world and asking these people or forcing these people to do forced work and slavery in many ways, slavery then in many ways. And those systemic issues have been provoking or facilitating the action and the business of the human traffickers. In the FCJA, as I said, we focus in international cases and human trafficking for labor exploitation, but we are prepared for sexual exploitation cases, domestic. Actually, we have several cases in domestic servitude. Forced marriage, we don't have the experience, but we have the partners to work together in those cases. Child soldiers, organs harvesting, that there are not so common in Canada, that not common. However, we have been talking, having conversations, roundtables about these cases to engage. We need to be prepared to address the cases or to support other organizations to look for remedies for those cases. We emphasized in the concept of not only in the definitions of the United Nations for human trafficking, but also we try to connect the definitions and the protocols, the Palermo protocols that are the international agreements and the definitions to develop policies and actions against human trafficking. We have included ILO, the International Labour Organization, also definitions, because we want to see the intersectionality between sex exploitation and labor exploitation. That is one of the reasons we put together, and we always, when we sustain the cases, and we make submissions to immigration, or we call CBSA or the police to discuss a case, we try to put the concepts of the forced labor and the human trafficking, trying to find the intersectionality and the explanation and supporting and how to address those cases better, that sometimes there are no tools or not enough services or information about. Forced labor happens everywhere, not only Canada, everywhere. And we have been seeing that in Europe in these days during the pandemic, particularly human trafficking for labor exploitation has been growing up as a crime, but also in Canada. Let me tell you very briefly a case we have in these days. I'm going to contextualize in this slide, just to mention that happened everywhere. Right before the pandemic, a group of migrants from Mexico came to Canada, and they were sold with a program in Mexico that they were offered to study English here, 1 month English training, that they were paying around $3,000 to $4,000. Some of them pay $5,000 for that program, additionally to the flight ticket and other components, but only to have the opportunity to come to Canada. And that included 1 month in a small school, sometimes not regulated, very clear school, and also a couple of visits, one to the Niagara Falls, other to the CN Tower, and that was the package, $5,000. As you may know, Mexicans don't need a visa, and they only need the ETA, the Electronic Travel Authorization. That is something that you can file online in 5-7 minutes. is less than $20. However, these people are abusing of the not information, no connection between the governments and international information about how to migrate, what are the procedures, what are the ways, and these people take advantage of the lack of information, and they offer these programs. And many people have been exploited with those programs. But during the when the pandemic started, then they were just released from the school. And suddenly, apparently, we can say that properly, that is a police work, it's not our work, but probably connected with the school, so probably connected with those who were the recruiters in Mexico. Some people appear in Toronto with a Facebook page offering those who were without nothing to do, stuck in Toronto, say, okay, come to work in Leamington. You are going to have now pathway to the permanent residence. You are going to have money, a lot of work, et cetera, et cetera. And they ask again money for this opportunity. Without any protocols, any protection, they put these people, these workers. We are talking about here a case of 14 workers, but there is hundreds. But this specific case, 14 workers, they were put, 17 workers, they were put in two vans. Then two minivans packed shoulder to shoulder without social distance, without protection, traveling more than 3 hours together in that small vehicle. And then they were put in a house, in a rooming house in Leamington, and in Windsor and Leamington, particularly Leamington. And they were 24, 26 people living in a house. And worst, there were beds shared between two people, two workers sleeping in the same bed, and working in different farms. Then they were in connection with other people, with hundreds of people during the day, then sleeping together, without protection, without protocols, without information. That was one of the reasons that outbreak in COVID-19 appeared in the Windsor Access area, because those workers, they were going every day to the convenience stores. On the weekend, they were going to the laundry spaces to make laundry for the clothes, etc. But they were having meetings and talking with the community, involved, walking around. And when the outbreak was known, was too late, because for so many weeks they were infected and bringing this contagious to other people. And worse, we found that those who were with no status, because this recruiter in Toronto was dealing with a contractor and the contractor was dealing with the employer. Then the employer apparently didn't know nothing. The employer was paying to the contractor and the contractor to the recruiter. And finally, the workers were getting just below the minimum wage. However, the employer was paying to the contractor or to the recruiter were paid more than $20 per hour. Additionally, the workers were changed, the rules of the work. They were put to work instead to pay hourly. Then they started being paid by weight. They needed to work more hours in order to get enough weight, in order to get enough money, working 14, 13 hours from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. without breaks, without enough protection, et cetera, et cetera. And those kind of cases have been happening. And this is physically labor exploitation. And in some cases, when the workers have been threatened, when the workers have been forced to stay, when they have been told that they can't speak with nobody because they're going to be deported, et cetera, et cetera, there is in the edge, in the line of human trafficking for labor exploitation. Just to mention that it's happening in Canada, happening everywhere, but also here. And not happening only with workers. We knew a case in which a son broke his mother, and the son was traveling. It was well before the pandemic, very busy, and he brought the son to support the wife because the wife was pregnant, but there was another kid. And then suddenly one of the parents of the woman also came because wanted to be close to her because of the pregnancy. Then the mother or the man started working, not only taking care of the kids, but cooking, cleaning, taking care of the other elder. She was working on call, and something like this happened in a family. Can you imagine when it's no family member? In other situation, we have found caregivers who have been extremely abused, threatened, even hit. They have been punished in different ways that against dignity, against human rights, against labor standards in our province. That kind of cases happen also a lot. We had an international student also case, happened a little before the pandemic. It was very interesting because a person who is illustrated, is educated, a youth, I would say, a very young person with English. However, because she was short of money and this international student have some few hours to work, she was looking for a job. She was getting not enough money. Another student said, "Okay, let's go to work in a massage parlor." She became working in that massage parlor place. And in that place, the man, the owner of the place, managed to take some pictures, and then threatened her, saying if she didn't accept to do other kind of works in the place, to stay longer, to do erotic massages, etc., etc., he was going to show the pictures in Facebook. And that was the way that everything started. And she was forced to labor, to sex. And we are talking about here an international student. There were the intersectionality, the two cases happening in that moment. What we have in the center, we have the migrant workers mobile program. And we say mobile because we want to go to the places. We want to visit the places. We want to create awareness in the places, through info sessions, to workshops, to community building, doing a partnership with other organizations, in order to identify potential cases of labor exploitation. We collect information and we do case management. And the case management is very important because we do the intake assessment, but also after the intake assessment, we try to provide meaningful referrals for the clients, like for legal aid, for lawyer, to do a labor claim before the Minister of Labor, but also to do some immigration claim can be to apply for an open work permit, to apply for a TRP, temporary resident permit, or for a humanitarian and compassion application. We see what kind of remedy can be possible for the person according to the situation, according to the time he or she has been living in the country, according to any other, some other factors. And we do also advocacy for policy change. We have, for instance, just to mention two things. We are part of a group called non-name group. It has no name, but in that group is the OPP, is immigration, is the IRCC, is the Crown Attorney, four or five organizations, the Toronto Police, and a legal clinic, and the FCJA Refugee Center. We meet before the pandemic. After the pandemic, have been a little bit slow down, but before the pandemic, we used to meet every 2 months to discuss what to do, how to address the cases. We were bringing cases to the table, groundwork, to say how we can do better, and trying to also to learn what are the moves or what are the perspectives from the government or from the police, from the CBSA, on the cases, in order to make a better approach, a holistic, a human rights approach in the situation. That is the program in general. We have been doing also a little bit of research, and we are participating in a couple of research now with the University of Ontario in Oshawa, and also with York University, trying to document cases, to bring statistics, numbers, trends in gender, but also in what kind of labor exploitation, what kind of breach against the labor standards, the employment standards have been happening in the province, that kind of things. and also mapping services that are possible for the workers. Sometimes happen that there are services, but the workers are isolated, very close to the service, but isolated with no access to the services. But sometimes it's because the workers are isolated in a remote areas and no enough services in the area. Then the two scenarios we try to address. I already spoke about this slide. That was the slide I was looking before. The human social justice approach, the international cases, the labor trafficking, and the partnership with grassroots organizations. This is the that I already spoke. I will prefer to talk a little bit about this graph. As a part of the work we do in the Toronto Counter Human Trafficking Network, one of the organizations there, Find Help, that have the capacity, they have the in their premises, they have the capacity, the knowledge and experience. Because they were running before a provincial line, helpline, the 211, and one of the components of the line was human trafficking. We decided in the network to invite the organization to provide information about the cases. And was for the first time we did, and we analyzed and we provide information on labor trafficking in versus other forms of human trafficking. And we found that before that study, before this exercise, almost 90%, 89% was sex trafficking, 89%. With 27, in this participated 25 organizations, with 25 organizations participating in this study, just one providing information on labor, that was FCJA, my organization, we found the following outcome, that 35% of the cases were labor trafficking. That means if many other organizations start documenting labor trafficking, probably the labor trafficking will be higher than other forms of human trafficking. This is just to create the awareness that we need to do a little bit more on labor trafficking, and we need to do a little bit more on international cases without, of course, ignoring by nothing the those more common ways of human trafficking, like sex trafficking or forced marriage or domestic servitude. Those kind of human trafficking, we cannot ignore them, of course, but we need to implement a little bit more in labor trafficking. Many victims in Canada are temporary foreign workers. Let me tell you, let me share that in Canada, every year, minimum, there is a minimum that 80,000 migrant workers, temporary foreign workers, comes every year to Canada. And from that number, almost half, 39,000, almost 40,000 workers come only to Ontario. Just to mention that only in Leamington, there are 8,000 workers just in that area only. Ontario is one of the centers receiving and getting migrant workers from different countries, particularly from the Caribbean and Central America and Mexico, also from Philippines, Indonesia, and Thailand. I mentioned here those who come with work permit, but there are in the country, many have been saying that at least in 2014, when the first number were released, they said 500,000, around 500,000 underground people without status, workers underground were in Canada. Today, many have been saying that at least can be 1 million people working underground. We are talking about 1 million human beings contributing to the economy, working, and we don't know in what conditions many of them have been doing this, because they don't have access to services and they are afraid. They are underground and they try to avoid the authority. They try to avoid the services because they are afraid that can be deported, and now they are getting money and sending money to their families. What beautiful would be if Canada in some time provide a remedy, a, a, we are not saying asking permanent resident or citizenship, but to start at least with that open work permit to regularize them and to facilitate them to pay taxes, for instance. That will be helpful for the country. Most of the victims of human trafficking are migrant workers. And let me tell you one example. One of the cases, or one of the gaps in the law, in the immigration policies and programs, is that the tied work permits. Tied work permits means permits that bring the name of the employer. Then I'm Luis, but working for Mr. Leon or working for Mr. Jose, whatever. And then Mr. Jose is in my work permit. Sometimes, not everyone, of course, there are wonderful employers, magnificent, respectful, and amazing human beings, employers. But there are, as always and everywhere happen in the world, there are some employers that are not that nice. And some, the advantage that their name is in the work permit, they feel that they are the owners of the work. Because those workers can't go to work in another place. They have to work just in this place. And we have found cases in which those employers lend the workers to another employer, like objects. Okay, you have to go to work in this other employer. That is illegal. That is not right. The person is coming for this specific employer with specific agreements in the contract. However, everything is changed, the way they are paid, and the housing conditions, the access to services, the information, the safety. Sometimes workers, we have a case of a group of Caribbean workers in between Waterloo and Kitchener, a case we have been dealing with, that they went to the field to work just 2 hours. That was a special crisis in the farm. They were needing the work urgently, and the protocol say that a worker needs to be trained, needs to be informed, needs to be properly made the worker to understand about the use of the machines, the tools, etc., but particularly those toxics and liquids and all these things they use that create risks for them when the people is not properly informed and properly given with the instruments, gloves, and materials to protect them from the use of these chemicals. We have a case in which the worker became intoxicated. Of course, they were not prepared, they were not properly dressed, and they needed at least 6 hours, I don't know, one day to adjust. Anyway, when you travel to other country and you are new, you need a little time to be properly settled and to start doing the work. Kind things like that happen. And also, we have a case we have been dealing in these days with this case during the pandemic, but the case started before the pandemic. A group of migrant workers from Philippines, they were working without status in Taiwan. They were in vulnerable situation in Taiwan, but they were from Philippines. They were working there, and a Canadian a recruiter from Calgary went to Taiwan, or he was in Taiwan, whatever, and he offered to bring these workers to solve the situation. He knew that they were without status, without documents in Taiwan, suffering. They said, don't worry, let's go to Canada. Canada is better. There are a better future, money, safety, etc. I need just $8,000 each one, or you guys have to pay me $8,000, and I'm going to find you a place and everything in Canada. The workers made loans. They spent the savings. One of them went fast, and he married his girlfriend and now his wife, and then he got money from her, etc. It was a tragedy because all this money just to pay this wonderful, amazing opportunity they were told by this recruiter. They came. We're talking about here 14 workers. 13 or 14 workers, 13 because one of them passed away in these days. 2 weeks ago passed away. We don't know exactly what was with the COVID-19, was for other reason, but anyway, now is the group is small. And these workers came to Quebec initially. And this recruiter didn't do properly things. He misled them to do misrepresentation. They didn't provide all the information, enough information. And of course, the applications they submitted failed. They initially got a work permit, but once the work permit expired, they were not able to renew it. And the immigration discovered that they did misrepresentation. Some of them were professional. They didn't provide information about the profession because they were coming just to cut meat in a factory. And this man said, "Don't worry, let me, I'm gonna fix this." And they put them to lie and to do this, all these bad things. The employer, who was nice when he knew about the situation, he said, "Okay, sorry, I'm gonna offer a job for you guys. However, you need to provide me a work permit, but without a permit, I can give you a work job. Then come here again when you have the work permit." Then they become in limbo. They pay to a lawyer and a consultant in Quebec another $4,000 to $5,000 plus the $8,000 they had paid in Taiwan. Nothing happened. They remained in limbo without status. And suddenly, another Filipino, in this case a woman, appeared, show up through Facebook, and she knew about the case. We don't know how, and she said, "Okay, come to Ontario. I have the solution for you guys. Work for me, and I'm gonna find a lawyer, and I'm gonna make deductions for everything. You are gonna be legal, and you're gonna get permanent residence." This woman, 2 years, deducted around $22,000 from each worker. We are talking about now between all the expenses, between $40,000 to $42,000 every worker they paid. But let me tell you in between what happened. This woman threatened them. She put them to work in several stores in the city, Food Basics, and I think, and the other one was no frills, but Food Basics for sure, I know. And also in a factory cutting meat. And she ordered them that if they wanted to get permanent residence, they had to remain in silence. No more complaints, no more calls, no more nothing, and just to wait. And you are going to be deducted all the money for the process. She was deducting for CPP, for employment insurance, for WSIB, for everything. However, nothing of that was going to the institutions. And she was deducting money to pay a lawyer. And she provided the name of the lawyer. And we called the lawyer in the case to say, "Okay, we have here several cases in which you have been supporting the work." He said, "No, sorry, but I have been no." A contractor just came to me, provide me the names and ask me for information, but nothing else happened, no case, nothing. She didn't bring information. But in the real life, she was getting money to supposedly to pay the lawyer. Ways, and they were put to sleep and to live in rooming houses. And during these 2 years, that was clearly human trafficking for labor exploitation. They were like slaves. One day they saw in the media that the woman was in the Toronto Star portrayed as a human trafficker, because in another case that exploded in the media, she was portrayed, and they were surprised, and they looked for her, and she disappeared. Now we are dealing with this case. This is a woman who has been very well known. She won one case against the worker. She became innocent, but she has now two or three more cases that she needs to face with the justice. We will see what happened. But that has been a terrible ways to breach the Canadian laws, the Canadian human rights, the Canadian labor laws. Everything has been breached in this way. And there is another gap that I want to mention. happened that the recruitment process in Canada has not been properly regulated. For instance, recruiters are not enlisted. There are ghosts. We don't know who are the recruiters. Other provinces like British Columbia, like Alberta, have implemented now that the recruiters have to be enlisted. They have to be well known. They have to be open to respond for situations, but not in Ontario. And also, here it's easy to register a company. You can go and register a company just with the driver license or with any document. You can register a company, and then you become no Luis, no Lisa. Now you're gonna be Lisa Inc. or Luis Inc. You're gonna be a company. And then the temporary employment agencies take advantage of the situation and they just hire not a person, they hire another company, the company to company. That is a way to exploit people, because this person without status is paying, let's say, $14 per hour or $15, but he or she needs to pay all the deductions and all the taxes on everything, etc. Then finally, it's going to get very, very, very below for the minimum wage, very, very. And finally, they can do nothing with this for the immigration. Those kind of gaps or failures facilitate the exploitation. And in these days, during the pandemic, those situations have been worse, because the recruiters and exploiters have been taking advantage to put people to work in a way and threatening them. And because there are no flights in this moment and there are restrictions to travel, people became more vulnerable and more easygoing to be exploited. Why we emphasize in international cases? We emphasize in international cases because, you know, the language barriers many times happen a lot, except for workers from India and a few other countries, some from the Philippines and some from the Caribbean. The rest of the workers doesn't speak the English or doesn't speak well, and they are incommunicated to make them more vulnerable. The gender identity is a situation. There is a situation. We have a case of Guatemalan women in the Ajax and Whitby area, in which this group of women working in a mushroom farms, they were abused not only by the supervisor, but they were abused by other workers. And they were, it was, two of them were indigenous, almost with just no good Spanish, but of course not English, coming in this program for agricultural workers. And they were, and a person who was declared, identified himself as LGBTQ, was totally abused, totally humiliated with words, with where then gender identity and sexual identity issues make people more vulnerable sometimes in those isolated, because no education, no information, no respect sometimes. Cultural barriers, of course, experience with violence, people who have been facing violence. For instance, we have a client from Honduras, and he was very several, I will say, terribly abused in London, and in a farm factory, and he was accepting the situation because he was coming from a place who, in Tegucigalpa, the capital of Honduras, that's very violent, and he thought that things that were happening to him was normal. But no, it are not normal, because we in Canada have different protocols and different ways to respect and to address the relations. That kind of things, experience with violence also facilitate the vulnerability. And the intersectionality of all these elements make even worse the situation. Who are the precarious migration people in Canada? Refugee claimants, refugees who have been refused, temporary foreign workers program, workers, as I told you, they have no, most of them, or the majority of them, that don't have pathway to the permanent residence, they have time work permit, international students, visitors, people, of course, people without non-status, And also those who have been break down in sponsorships. Sponsorship is when a husband or wife brought a partner from the from other country, and then in these sponsorships, in the regulations, they were obligated, forced to live together at least for 2-3 years in order to continue the process and to be granted with the permanent residency. Sometimes when the sponsorship is break down and the person becomes out of the status, it's very difficult because it's not only the vulnerability person who doesn't want to get back to the country because made many plans, the family was confident that the new life was going to start, and then suddenly here was abused, the marriage was break down, and then the person becomes in a limbo, doesn't want to get back because the situation, can't stay here because have no rights, nothing, no documents. Those are those cases make more vulnerable the victims for to be abused, labor trafficked, etc. As I said, the intersectionality, all these things, the intersectionality, race, disability, nationality, gender identity, and sexual orientation, and others factors create a strong situation of vulnerability. That is important to have anti-oppressive lens, a human rights scope, an open-minded side to the situation. We have here the policy that we address the cases in a different ways according to the situation. Sometimes slowly she goes on alone, or she goes with another worker, with Natalie, with one of my colleagues. Sometimes I'm going, but we try to create the rapport and the situation to facilitate the environment for the person to disclose and to allow us to go beyond and to support. But for that, we need an anti-oppressive lens and human rights scope and a holistic approach to do this kind of work. The idea is to break down that cycle of exploitation, the lack access to access to services, isolation, language barrier, cultural barriers, etc., etc. That cycle, that intersectionality, the idea is to break down this with intervention. And the intervention has to be with consent, educating the person, explaining why we do this, why she or he is able to do this, and why Canada provides these tools, why it's important to do it. That is the way to break down that cycle, and this is the way we prepare the how to address the cases. And we have been doing a collaborative collaboration with the institutions, particularly, let me tell you a sample. There is a sample for a case called Wasaga case. We received here a couple sometime, and that was in 2018. A couple came with two kids. They were reluctant to explain about the situation. They were just saying that it was possible for them to come to Toronto, where to stay, and we say why, what is happening, what is going on. And finally, the woman, when the man was to the Watson and she was alone, she started crying and she said, look, my husband don't want to speak about this, but we are living in a house with 28 people or 29 people in Berry, and we are desperate because we have the room is just a curtain, and there are several curtains in a room. They created four rooms, and they are sleeping with others, with our kids. But this is not the worst. The worst is we are paying $400 rent each. Then they were paid $800. And we had to pay because the woman who had this house, she had deducted the money directly from our payments. That was terrible for us to know that case. And we decided to talk to the man, say, okay, we created the rapport, the environment, and he was, he at the end was also crying, saying, okay, I was afraid because I don't want to get back to Mexico. We lost everything. We paid 60,000 pesos to come here. We sold the vehicle, we sold everything we had, and this is for me is a failure. I don't want to fail my family. I'm staying there for a few days more in order to find solutions, but we are desperate, etc., etc. And we documented the case, and we sent the case to the police, and we requested to immigration a PRP for this couple. Something happened very special, very special. We lost the case in immigration. Immigration didn't consider them victims of human trafficking, even though we explained all the issues, how they were threatened, how this person took pictures and everything from this employer had connections in Mexico, and this employer said, if something happened here in Canada, your family will need to respond. Then they were afraid to go to the police because the family in Mexico, these people have connections in Mexico, connections here. They were using a Uber driver to bring them to the airport, the Toronto Pearson Airport to Barry, and then put it in that house. When we reported to the police all this, the police said that they were going to put attention to the case. But we were so sad because immigration denied the PRP for two reasons. One, they were not locked. For instance, they were able to come here. They lied. They say that they were going to bring the one of the kids to a doctor because it was sick. And also to go to a park. And then the woman said, okay, but you need to be here in the afternoon. And they came to Toronto and they went to, they somebody by Facebook or something sent them to another organization, and this organization sent them to FCJ. And they were in rush. They needed to get back to Barry. And we say, no, I don't think so. It's good for you guys. Just call that you are unable to go, etc., etc. Well, okay, they finally stay with us. What I'm saying is that immigration denied the TRP because they were not locked. And for sex trafficking, most of the cases in sex trafficking, the person is locked in a house or in a room. And also they were holding the passport. The passport was not seized by the exploiter. In the labor trafficking happened a lot that the passport and the documents are seized by the human trafficker. In this case, they were holding the passport and they were not locked. And then the officer said, because you were not locked and you were having the passport, why you didn't leave and go to the country? And that was totally unfair because the officer was acting accordingly to the guidelines, because that is the guideline said. However, we as an organization, we were seeing the things different. They were recruited in Mexico. They paid 60,000 pesos for that, plus the tickets. They were put in a rooming house here. They were forbidden to speak with anyone, and they were threatened with the police and with the authorities. If they speak, they were going to be deported. And also they were threatened with the families in Mexico, and they were put in these places. And this woman created a very toxic environment in the place of work. She was creating a competition. Those who produce, who do better, who complain less, et cetera, they are in the list to work next week. That means that some of them didn't have the opportunity to work every week, but they needed to pay rent. That means that less working, but paying the debts, they would get just nothing of money at the end of the month. And also she create a toxic environment, putting some of them in a better places, cleaning hotels, but others that just doing other kind of hard work in demolition or things in construction in other places. She was using the kind of work she provided in the way to punish them according to the behavior. But also she was deducting $6 every day for transportation. She was deducting $13 for the right to work every day. If you work today, you need to pay $13. Plus, she was getting the money from the employers. One of the employers told us, we are working very well with this employer now. It's a good employer in a hotel. That is the name of the hotel. And this employer said, I was paying $23 the hour. But this recruiter was paying to the workers only $9 to $11. The rest was for deductions. the police discovered that she had 3 houses and 2 cabins. She was packed of people. Everyone asking $400 for rent, making deductions. Can you imagine the big amount of money she was doing with this, labor case exploitation? Finally, the police came with us again. That happened in December 2018. Invite us, say, okay, you were right. This is a labor trafficking exploitation. We discovered more houses, more cabins, et cetera, et cetera. We were we went to visit the places. And the police on January put this on the media. And the media exploded in Canada, and we knew that there was a human trafficking for labor exploitation in Berry and Wasaga. That case was in collaboration with CBSA, with the police, with victim services, and other organizations. And we participated in referring. And then we got back to immigration. And this time, the immigration gave issued the TRP for this couple and for the others, 60 workers, because the police released a statement saying those workers found in Wasaganberry, they were victims of human trafficking for labor exploitation. With this statement, we used the statement, and then the immigration was able to grant the TRP. That kind of collaboration facilitate the issues, facilitate the way we address the case. And now, very brief about the protection. What kind of protections we have? The initial one is the temporary permanent, resident permit, the TRP. The problem with the TRP, as I mentioned before in the case, needs a statement. Can be from Service Canada, can be for the Minister for Labor, can be from the CBSA, from the police, about the case in order to immigration to be able to provide the TRP. If no, no. And it's so difficult to get the statement, and it's so difficult to get, for instance, we have recently had a case in which public health and other organizations contacted us for a case in Ajax, case in Waterloo, and other, some police raids, the police were going to do some police raids, but no statement. Then, if no statement, those workers is still now without status, because we can bring them to immigration. We need a statement. We need something to say, these workers were found in these and these conditions, and we consider that they have been victims of exploitation in Canada, because the employment standards were breached, because human rights or the housing condition, et cetera, were breached. With that statement, we are going to be able to support them to get immigration, to get the TRP. But now, until now, nothing, because no statement. We have been waiting. We have been asking the workers to push for that. And this is something that we are going to address in these days. And when the open work permit is granted, it's coming with IFH, that is the Internal Federal Health, is like the OHIP for the workers, quite similar. And they can work, and they can study. They can have more services with this. However, there are limitations. No pathway to permanent residency, it's temporal. And the way that the TRP is granted is discretionary by the officer. There are no clear guidelines. The guidelines are more developed and more designed for sex trafficking. We need more consistency in the human trafficking, particularly for labor exploitation. This is something we have been doing advocacy with the CCR, the Canadian Council of Refugees, with the Migrant Rights Network, and other organizations, try to find more consistency for this. And the other is the worker has to be witness, has to be collaboration with the police, and only after 5 years TRP, the person can be invited to apply for permanent residency under the permit holder class. That is very difficult. It's a very difficult situation. There is another remedy now that created by the government last year, the open work permit for vulnerable workers. That permit is to provide a permit for those who have the name of the employer and have been abused. And that means that they had a labor market in Canada. They have a valid work permit, but they are not able to work in other place, because they only can work in the place that the name is posted in the work permit. And the open work permit is a good remedy. However, the difficult issue here is that it's very complicated for the worker to sustain the abuses because it's the war of the worker against the war of the employer. We have found that many cases have been rejected, but some of them have been approved. We used to provide an affidavit for them, and they attest that everything is true, and they document the situation, the abuses, what kind of abuses they faced in the place, and if they got injuries, et cetera, et cetera. And then with this affidavit and with this declaration, they can be granted with the open work permit. But there is a problem. The open work permit doesn't have pathway to permanent residence. Again, it's a temporary solution. And one of the most popular remedies we have is the humanitarian and compassionate application. The humanitarian and compassionate grounds is when the person has been facing hardship here in Canada for many years, but is still working, is still engaged in community, doing volunteer work, supporting the families, but having ties to the local community, showing that this is a person that probably is going to be a good asset for our society, and also the person has to demonstrate that is very difficult for the person to get back to the country because the poverty, discrimination, violence, and he or she has been living here for many years underground without status, providing for the family and from the distance. And from some country origin conditions, with all this sustained, we can get the humanitarian and compassionate application for them. This is a process that can take between 2 to 3 years, sometimes 4 years, depending on the situation. There are also gaps. Until the application is approved, the person is in risk to be deported. Also, it's very discretionary for the officer, no clear guidelines on this. Also, until the initial approval is done, the person is not entitled to any benefits, no services, nothing. And then that kind of put the person in risk and vulnerability for long. But this is a good, beautiful remedy, and we use a lot of humanitarian and compassionate application. I just wanted to mention just very fast the housing supports we do. It's very important, this component, because housing is an issue. It's a crisis in the city, crisis in the province, a crisis in the country with the housing conditions. But there are programs, and particularly I want to highlight this program, a special priority housing for survivors of domestic abuse, have been good because when we can sustain and the victim can sustain the domestic abuse, can be with an affidavit, a declaration, letters of support. The support organization like FCJ, the person can be granted with this support, and it's a minimum 6 months, and the person can pay the rent, can find a place to rent, and this is very, I would say, a blessed, a very good program. However, in general, there are a crisis because not enough places, not enough, and many people is in waiting list to get support for housing. We have found that sometimes organizations are not well prepared to address when they are victims and survivors of human trafficking. You know that a person who has been facing abuses have been destroyed. One of the workers I mentioned here, a Filipino who was in Taiwan, that he went unmarried. His marriage was broke down, and another one lost these last seven, eight years with his little son who was two years old when he came here to Canada. And they have been losing a beautiful part, a beautiful component of their lives in their countries, but they can't get back because they are now with a lot of debts because the money lenders there, and sometimes the money lenders are dangerous, and they can get back just without nothing in the hands to the countries. And they came here doing well paying. As I say, they pay between $40,000 to $42,000. This is a big extra huge amount of money. We don't need that amount of money coming to get documents. With maximum 5,000 will be enough or less. But they did well. They paid. They tried to do well, but couldn't because the system failed. The gaps in the system that facilitated the exploiters to act against them. That we need to, when we address a case like that, a person who is destroyed in the well-being, and a person who, like the student who was abused, sexually abused and labor abused, and a person who is totally afraid to get back to her country, to her family, to her neighbors, destroyed, we need to have a different scope, a different approach to that person. We need to be properly informed in trauma issues and how to do it. If we don't have the capacity then to bring somebody with the training, with the capacity, with the knowledge, with the wisdom to address the situation. And one of the things with this beautiful program of housing is that only women under domestic abuse can apply. Then there are many others that suffer other kind of situation, and they can apply for this program. It's very difficult to get the allowance. There is also a municipal allowance, between $400 to $600. Very good that we have been getting this for some of the victims of survivors of human trafficking. I wanted to mention because we also need to recognize that things have been doing well, good, and are supported for the clients we see. The only thing we complain is sometimes too many conditions, IDs, all these things that sometimes people have lost everything and they need to start zero from zero without nothing, without documents, and without hope. That is more even worse. The status is an issue when the person has non-status at all, can get these benefits. Needs to be citizen to permit the permanent residency or be at least in a implied status, meaning that an application is on the way. That kind of things made so difficult for the victims to get this, and they also in the cost of the rent market is very terrible. Now a simple room in a house is costing between $600 to $800. And a basement $1,500 and an apartment $2,000 is very expensive, and the allowance are low. Then is things are difficult. However, we have been trying to manage the situation and to support as much as possible the clients. Sorry for being so long. I didn't stop talking. Now, Lisa, dear participants, I'm open for questions, comments, or conversation. Totally open, and the time you need, I will be here, okay?
Thank you, Luis. So I think what we'll do is, Luis, if you can stop sharing your screen.
Yes, let me see. Share. I stopped sharing the screen? Stop, no?
Yeah, stop.
Okay. How that? Oh, I don't know.
Maybe at the bottom it says share. There you might have a stop sharing.
Yes, share. I did share. I open share and then.
Okay, don't worry about it. I'll look for people with their hands up on. Oh, there we go. Oops. You had it figured.
I don't know what I did, but sorry.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is I will pay attention to the participant panel. And look to see if there are any hands up at this point in time. We have one comment from somebody in the chat. It said, thank you very much, Luis. Very insightful.
Thank you. Thanks. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
Does anyone have any comments? Sorry?
Questions, comments mm-hmm. about the cases? Mm-hmm.
I'm not actually able to see anybody's hands up. I apologize. We're having some technical difficulties here. There's one raised hand I see.
Ah, now I opened the chat here right now. I can see. Thank you very much. Thank you, Rebecca. The stories really bring the issue home. Thank you. Okay, only thank yous and comments in that way. Thank you so much.
Okay, wait a minute. Domenico has a question.
Ah, okay, perfect.
Let me find Domenico and I'll unmute him. Sorry, Domenico, I'm having trouble finding you.
Okay, I found myself and then
there you go.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you, Luis. Great presentation. I was wondering about how do we assess a situation? We might be talking to a client. I know that in the past Toronto Public Health has actually gone into a particular home with a number of migrant workers living there. Mm-hmm. And, on a surface level, everything can seem fine. Like, there's no issues. They're all, people are friendly. They're answering our questions about their close contacts with COVID. And we leave and we think, okay, everything is fine. But there are times when not everything is fine, where there are people being exploited, there's trafficking going on, and sometimes people feel nervous to talk openly about their situation because they fear deportation. They don't want to raise any suspicions on the part of government. So how do we do how do we approach assessing the situation more accurately in these cases?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Domenico, because that is an important issue we have been facing too. Sometimes we have found that the protocols for the COVID-19 are properly established in place. However, that it doesn't mean that the Employment Standards Act are respected, and also dignity and other issues. But the best way we do an intake assessment in which we don't mention for nothing labor exploitation or human trafficking, we just ask them or we establish a conversation saying, okay, how is the conditions for you? What are your plans? What kind of documents you have, what have been promised. And then in that way, when we establish a rapport, we can go a little bit beyond. And when we start informing, that in Ontario it's illegal to pay less than this and that, or you need breaks, these kind of breaks, or you work in a holiday or Sunday, you need to be paid 1.5. Etc. etc. When we start saying things like that, say, "Oh no, I don't have this. I don't have that. I don't have this," and then at the end, sometimes we discover that person has been also paying for the documents, but no documents at all, no nothing, or was promised with the or deducting money for the documents, or they paid recruitment fees that is illegal, is not tolerated by the law, and that is against the law. But most of them, they paid recruitment fees. That kind of things are in place. That is the way when we establish the rapport. The best way is to we have a WhatsApp. With the WhatsApp, we start chatting with them, and sometimes they are just no reluctant, they are open to share a little bit more information, and according to the information they share, we can go beyond. We need to invite them to be part of the chat, or we need to invite them to an info session, or to say, well, you don't come, and to see what we can do for you in immigration. But when is immigration, when is giving free advice in immigration, the exploiters are not afraid because it's immigration and something that they can see that a solution for them as well. But once we start talking about immigration, then we include the topic of labor. And that is the way we discovered that there is something was going on that was wrong.
Luis, I have another question in the chat. This appears at this point in time to be the only one I have. So if anyone has additional questions, please add them. We've got about 10 minutes left if we need the time. So Rebecca is asking, do you partner with public health in other cities where you do your work? And how can public health help?
Yes, Rebecca. Before going to Rebecca's question, I want to close with something for Domenico. Domenico, something that we can do together and many others can support in this. We need more information in the airport, in the airports, in the ports of entrance in Canada, and also in the consulates and embassies and in the agreements we have internationally about the recruitment process, about the labor laws in Canada. And also this information should be in different languages, in Spanish, in Tagalog, in other different languages. If people get information, but also numbers, the hotline, the WhatsApp, et cetera, maybe they find a way to communicate that something is not going well in the farm or in the factory, whatever they are working. There is a case, sorry, Rebecca, I'm going with you, but we got a case in the days in the worker lost a finger in a construction. Another worker that he's working with Brazilian and he is from Mexico. One of the Brazilian workers that is very close to the supervisor, the boss, intentionally allow something to come down. Anyway, the worker lost a finger. And then he was just given painkillers. And because he was without status, he didn't get enough attention and he was infected. But this is nothing. He was before that, he was pushed for another worker from the second floor to the first in a fight, and then he got an injury in the back, and he was working injured, but now with a finger. This case is very, he doesn't speak English, but also he doesn't speak Portuguese, and he's working with Portuguese speaking people, and he had been totally abused, but he has no information. He didn't know. He exploded crying when he knew that there are WhatsApps, because he said, I have my number from Mexico and I have WhatsApp for my family. If I were known that I have possibility to speak to somebody in Spanish about my case, I will do it. I definitely, because I was in pain, but I couldn't leave these people because they threatened me, and the second I needed money, and my family is in a terrible situation back in Mexico, and I can get back to Mexico. Then that kind of thing, we need more information also to provide information in different languages, cards, pocket cards, WhatsApps, and to make more awareness and to educate the community, the public opinion about many things that happen out there and people don't know. We don't know. And Rebecca, thank you for the question. Yes, we don't have a specific partnership, but we do collaboration. For instance, we were called by public health in Waterloo, and through the OPP, we got the connection for a police raid that was done in the area. They were rescuing or taking some workers from the abusive situation they were, and then the public health contacted us. We established a conversation. We discussed some protocols, how to provide the information, how to, if we're necessary to go there, or et cetera, that kind of things also happened in Ajax recently. But in the past, we have had communication, particularly with victim services, through victim services to the public health when it's necessary, but not that much that we hope, not at the level we would like to have, to have it, but something we at least we have channels of communication. And the job, the work you do, guys, in the public area is an amazing is something that we have to honor, because in this time, during this pandemic situation, is when we have seen how valuable and how important and how meaningful is the health policies and the health support and the public health for those who are in a vulnerable situation.
Luis, that's very kind of you to say. It appears that we don't have any further questions at this time. So I'm just going to take a moment to thank you, Luis, for your commitment to sharing your knowledge and your experience, helping to guide us in better practice with migrant workers, with undocumented people. And I want to also ask the people who have participated to reflect back on and consider the acknowledgement that we began this workshop with, our learnings from today's workshop, and find active ways in our work, but also in our personal lives, to address the ongoing health inequities. Oops. I have one more question.
Oh, perfect.
Sandra, if you want to unmute yourself, you can go ahead and ask the question.
Hello, Luis. Thank you so much for your presentation. I do have a question. It's sort of off-center, kind of. I'm going back to the holding cells at the border of the U.S. and Mexico border.
Sorry, Tom. Sorry, I can listen, Sandra. I can't.
You can't hear? Can they hear?
Lisa? It's a bit quiet, Sandra.
Is it quiet? Okay, let me turn up my... Is this better? Hello?
Yes, it's better.
Is that better? Okay. I just have a question regarding the border crossing and where they have the refugees still in, you know, contained quarters. Are they getting access to any health services at all? And how are they dealing with the COVID-19, the packed quarters? I mean, that's a really big concern.
Yes. Yeah, thank you, Sandra, for the question. I was a little bit cutting up the communication, but I got it, the central part. Refugee claimants, in particularly, when you do a refugee claim, just doing the initial approach to the window to say I want to do a refugee claim. Just with that, the person receive a paper, an initial paper that create a file, and 1 to 2 weeks later, the person is going to get an admissibility interview that is also short, a few minutes. With that admissibility interview, the person is given with a brown paper. This brown paper allow them to get access to health. That is important. I think refugees can have access. The problem is for those who have been rejected, those who have no continuation in the process, those are more vulnerable because they became in a kind of limbo, and then they don't have access. We have been providing a lot of services here in our clinic for non-insured people. Unfortunately, there are 4 community centers in the city who have been receiving people without status. And when it's an emergency, a few, two, three months ago, a worker from Italy, by the way, from Europe, his son got a crisis I forgot the name for this illness when the sugar is so high. Diabetes. He didn't know that was diabetes. His son fainted, a little son, went to the hospital, no documents, and fortunately the hospital was able to provide the attention, and the little kid was safe. then that anyway, we have access to those things, but many people don't go for the test, for instance, for the COVID-19 test, because they are afraid because they don't have documents. We have been promoting, doing education and informing in Spanish and in different languages that people need to do it, because it's a safety for not only for them, but for everybody and for the country. And I need to say that the hospital have been very open this time, and the community centers and some doctors and have been also willing to support and to volunteer. I think the way we have addressed the case, the situation of the COVID-19 has been good by the city, by the province. Of course, there are gaps, difficulties, and the most difficult situation, Sandra, is those who have no papers, those who have no status. With those, we have more difficulties because they don't look for support. They are afraid to be deported or to be reported to the police. That is something that unfortunately is still happening.
Luis, I just to clarify, I think the beginning part of Sandra's question was cut off, and I'm not sure if you have the information on this. She was actually asking about the whether or not if you were aware through your networks of the conditions of the people in at the U.S. Mexican border who have been detained.
Okay. Yep. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. In these days, we participated with Loli in a webinar, in a conference organized by three hotlines, Mexico, U.S., Canada. Polaris from U.S. organized this forum, this conference, international conference. The conference was called Three Countries, Three Hotlines, Fighting Against Human Trafficking. Mm-hmm. And one of the topics that was addressed was the crisis generated by the COVID-19, and there is the outbreaks are not enough publicized. There are problems in the border, a lot of problems, lack of assistance, lack of services, and unfortunately, from especially from US, the attention has been not enough. Mexico has been trying to do the best as possible. Canada is doing very serious, taking very seriously this situation. But U.S. mostly has focused in the migration part, but the health part in those areas have been not well. Accordingly, what we heard in that conference is that there are outbreaks and there are people infected, and the situation is still in a. Is it bad in the border?
Thank you for that. I think what I'll do, because we have no more questions, but Rebecca has kindly given us something to close off on. And she said, this information should be taken to all public health units for staff and management to be aware. Also, the province should be including these issues as a part of public health priorities for our province, especially if Ontario has the largest percentage of migrant workers. Thank you for sharing this important reality with us. So on that note, I want to thank Luis. I want to thank all of you for joining us. And please spread the word to your colleagues who were not able to join today's webinar, and let them know that it will be posted for their viewing as well. Thank you, everyone.
Lisa, can I say something?
Sure, absolutely.
I'm going to send you the information about the hotline, the provincial telephones we have, the WhatsApp telephones numbers also, because can be useful for you guys to maybe to distribute to pass it to somebody who needed to communicate.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Luis.
Thank you so
much. Thank you, everyone.